If ever there were a singer who could speak to our deepest feelings, it's Dionne Warwick. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. That's what friends are for. I could go on and on, but it isn't only her music that has elevated Dionne from singer to legend. It's the way that she has used her voice to raise awareness about AIDS. Okay, so now you're probably wondering, why did Dionne also lend her voice to the Psychic Friends Network? Well, I'm just gonna let Dionne explain it. After all, this is her story, her words.
For 40 years, Dionne Warwick has been dazzling audiences with her soulful voice.
I grew up listening to Dionne Warwick, absolutely. She was one of the voices that blew me away in the 60s.
But her spectacular voice was often clouded by controversy.
I've been tested, trust me, and I'm still being tested in many areas.
In this business, oh my God. You know, this is the most unforgiving business in the world.
You know, life is too short, and I think Dionne is aware of that too because of the spiritual background that we both were raised in.
Time and again, Dionne would return to her family and faith to sustain her.
My grandpa always told me that God never puts anything on you more than he knows you can bear. And it's true.
Dionne's strong beliefs and sense of pride came from her parents, Mansell and Lee Warwick.
They say you choose your parents, and I feel very, very lucky that I chose those two people to be my mom and dad.
Dionne Warwick was born Marie Dionne Warwick on December 12, 1940, in East Orange, New Jersey.
My mother worked in a factory called Tungsol. She made the insides of the light bulbs. My dad was a Pullman porter, later to become a butcher, later to become a CPA. So he was a master of a lot of things.
Growing up in East Orange, Dionne, her sister Dee Dee, and brother Mansell Jr. were sheltered from the rampant racial prejudice of the 1950s.
I lived in a neighborhood that was virtually the United Nations. Every nationality, race, color, and creed lived there. We were wonderful neighbors. The neighborhood was full of kids who we all walked to school together. We all did our homework together. We had sleepovers at everybody's houses.
The Warwick family was expanded by the arrival of Dionne's Aunt Sissy.
Growing up with Dionne was quite interesting. It was wonderful, actually. We had it was like I was an older sister rather than an aunt.
Dionne's family life was centered around faith and music.
All of my mom's sisters and brothers were members of the church and the choir, as was my dad. First time I sang by myself was in my grandfather's church, St. Luke's AME Church in Newark, New Jersey. And he stood me on a stack of huge, huge, well, they weren't Bibles, they were like almost dictionary-sized books in his pulpit on a chair. And he asked me to sing Jesus Loves Me, and that's what I sang. I was 6 years old.
That first song was the start of Dionne's musical career. She sang throughout her childhood, and by the time she was a teenager, she was appearing on television as part of a gospel choir. It wasn't long before Dionne was getting professional backup work across the river in New York City for established hitmakers, including Dinah Washington, Ray Charles, and the Drifters. But even with her success as a backup singer, Dionne felt she needed a backup plan for her future.
Coming out of high school, and I received a scholarship from my church, and I was accepted at the Hart College of Music.
Dionne entered college with the idea of becoming a music teacher, but she couldn't ignore the calls coming in from the record companies.
I arranged my classes so that I could be in New York from Thursday through Saturday. And Sunday, I would drive back up to Hartford to make my classes on Monday. My mother used to get to this point where she said, well, I thought you were in school. I was home so much.
Dionne would soon be closer to home full time. In 1962, she met a young songwriter named Burt Bacharach.
I met Burt while doing a background session for the Drifters. He'd written a song called Mexican Divorce.
A voice like hers, I'd never heard. You know, they threw away the mold with Dionne. Immediately recognizable voice, as it turned out to be.
And during one of the rehearsals, Burt approached me and asked if I would like to do some demonstration records of songs that he was writing with a new songwriting partner named Hal David.
I guess she was 19, 18, and she looked beautiful. And she walked into our office with jeans, torn at the knee, smiling, and we asked her to sing for us. And she just blew us away. She was just so talented and so musical.
We knew she was something very unique, very special. Made a demo with her, got her signed to Scepter Records, and history started to get made from there.
My first recording, official recording, was Don't Make Me Over. Don't make me over now that I do anything for you. Don't make me over now that you know how I adore you.
It's a very strong statement for a woman to make. Don't make me over. You know, and don't change me. Don't, you know, accept me the way I am.
Accept me for what I am. Yes, accept me for things I do.
Within days, Don't Make Me Over became a hit, and Dion became an international sensation.
That was my first hit. It also became basically my graduation present from college.
The song also changed Dion's last name. A typo on the album cover misprinted Warwick as Warwick, and the name stuck.
And that was the beginning of Dion Warwick as an international record star and performer.
Coming up next, Dion Warwick breaks new ground.
Even though I was a black artist, they couldn't put me in that little box that they loved doing.
Then later, both Dion's personal and professional relationships fall apart.
All the people that knew our relationship, and I'm the last to know.
When Lifetime's intimate portrait of Dion Warwick continues. We now return to Lifetime's intimate portrait of Dion Warwick. At the tender age of 21, Dion Warwick skyrocketed to the top of the charts with the song Don't Make Me Over. It marked the beginning of a rewarding partnership with the songwriting team of Burt Bacharach and Hal David.
It was a very close relationship, the three of us. We just kept having hits. We'd write a song, play it for Dion. She'd say, let's do it.
We basically started enjoying some success together. So we were known in the industry, and it was so funny when I first heard this, I said, what are you talking about? But it said, a lot of people were calling us the triangle marriage that worked.
Dion was about to embark on a real marriage. In 1963, she married drummer-turned-actor Bill Elliott.
He was a drummer in a trio called the Rhoda Scott Trio. And they were recording, and we did some background work on their recording.
Billy was a handsome, very, you know, cavalier, that kind of thing. He was really wonderful.
And we took a fancy to each other and got married. And we stayed married the first time, I think it was about a year, if that long. And woke up one morning, I said, I don't think I'm supposed to be doing this, you know. So off I flew to Juarez and got, ironically, a Mexican divorce.
But Dion and Bill couldn't stay apart. Less than a year later, they remarried.
It's just a case of can't do it now.
This time, Dion expected it to be for good.
Bill was my first love, what you would call true love. Someone I felt was supposed to be in my life.
Dion's career continued to soar to new heights. She went on a world tour and followed up the success of Don't Make Me Over with one of her most popular songs, the 1964 hit Walk On By.
If you see me walking down the street and I start to cry each time we meet, walk on by.
I was really impressed with her, how laid back she was. She just sung her song and did her thing without a whole lot of hoopla, but it cut. You know, it cut. When she said, walk on by. You know, I said, uh-oh, wait a minute.
Walk On By made the top 10 of the pop charts and number one on the R&B chart. But Dion's achievement was so much greater than record sales.
it wasn't the greatest situation for black singers. You know, in those days, we were still trying to make our way and get people to respect us, whether we had a number one record or not.
But the songs of Bacharach, David, and Warwick transcended racial barriers, even at the height of racial conflict in America.
They called me the artist that bridged the gap. And bridging the gap basically meant that they couldn't categorize me. Even though I was a black artist, they couldn't put me in that little box that they loved doing with black artists and saying, you know, you're an R&B artist. And then they couldn't put me into the other little box that they reserved for white artists only by saying, you're a pop artist. I was music.
And the music was magical. The collaboration between Burt Bacharach, Cal David, and Dion produced some of the most popular songs of the 20th century.
It was exciting times. We were making history without really knowing that we were making history.
They were on a roll in that era when they wrote those songs. Every one of them was just fantastic.
We each had our own thing to do and depended upon each other to perform that function.
I think the thing with Dion and those songs that Hal and I wrote, they're kind of custom made for her.
Dion was their muse.
It's one thing to sit down and write a song at a piano and you get your lyrics together and the music together and you'd hear it in your head. But then when somebody does it the way you dreamed it would be, it is incredible.
Even in the midst of the British invasion, Dion remained a fixture of the pop charts with songs like Alfie and Message to Michael. In 1967, she scored hits with the theme song to the film Valley of the Dolls and the B-side cut, I Say a Little Prayer. The moment I
wake up. In England, we used to have people who covered those songs. I mean, Still Black did Anyone Who Had a Heart, and Sandy Shaw did There'll Always Be Something There to Remind Me. But, you know, it was Dion's records that's with the benchmarks, and those are the ones that everybody loved.
They were written for me. They're like a wonderful, wonderful dress that was designed and fitted on my body that nobody else can wear and no one else really can sing. They can interpret it in another fashion, but they belong to me.
In 1968, Dion won the Grammy for Best Contemporary Pop Vocal Performance for the song Do You Know the Way to San Jose?
San Jose was not one of my favorite songs at all. And I usually just sum it up by saying it and I cried all the way to the bank.
Dion's next hit, I'll Never Fall in Love Again, won her another Grammy in 1969. That year was pivotal for another reason. Dion made her movie debut in the film Slaves with Ossie Davis and Stephen Boyd.
Acting is only an extension of what I do anyway. And it was quite an experience for me. The film was shot in Shreveport, Louisiana. And at the time, I had just found out that I was pregnant with my first child. And I was also on tour.
Shortly after completing the film and the tour, Dion gave birth to a baby boy, David.
She was booming when I was born. She's right at a real, 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 you know, go get 'em point.
In 1971, Dion was awarded a contract with Warner Brothers Records. Bacharach and David came with her. With a major label behind them, the trio had nowhere to go but up. But things were about to take a turn for the worse.
I remember getting a call from my dad saying that, well, it's all over the streets, you know, Bacharach and David are splitting. I said, Daddy, come on. They're not splitting. Where'd you get that?
Bacharach and David had come to blows over a failed musical, but Dion, their friend, partner, and muse, was the last to know.
I never got a call from Bert. I never got a call from Hal. I was mortified. I said, what in the world? My two friends? And it really hurt me. It hurt me more than I think either of them will ever know. Now they will, because they'll see it.
I think that it was probably mostly my fault, you know. I know it was. I didn't look at the legal ramifications or the friendships, you know. I didn't feel like I wanted to write anymore.
And as a result of it, I had to sue them for breach of contract. Because if I didn't sue them, Warner Brothers was going to sue me for not sending him the product. That it was a mess.
So I got sued, and I should have been sued. And Dion didn't speak We didn't speak for 10 years.
By 1973, the 10-year collaboration that had produced an amazing body of songs was no more.
I did feel sad about the split, sure. But I also thought, either nothing goes on forever, no streak goes on forever.
It was a pretty devastating time for me because of the way that it happened. Not necessarily because it happened, because I had already experienced a divorce of a nature, and that was a personal nature. One that I never really dreamed would happen would be with Bacharach and David.
Coming up next, Dion faces another devastating loss.
His death was really traumatic for me. So my mom, for me, really stepped in.
Then later, Dion takes on hip-hop, and it's personal.
Here I am, thinking that I'm really starting to succeed, and she's shutting it down, and I'm going, Mom, what are you doing?
When Lifetime's intimate portrait of Dion Warwick continues. Lifetime's intimate portrait of Dion Warwick. After her professional split from songwriters Burt Bacharach and Hal David in 1973, Dionne Warwick bounced back with her duet with the Spinners, Then Came You. The song proved to be a one-off success, and Dionne decided to concentrate on motherhood. The year before, she had given birth to her second son, Damon.
Dionne is so much like me in the sense that our priorities may be different from a lot of others who are in the business, because our family and our children came first, believe it or not. You know, it was about David and Damon and Bill too.
But by 1975, Dionne's marriage was faltering, and she and her husband, actor and musician Bill Elliott, divorced.
It just didn't work. You know, it just happens that way sometimes. People stay married for 99 years, and some people stay married for 9 minutes. At least I stayed married for 12 years, you know.
We didn't know of dysfunction. We just saw love. So when my dad wasn't there, yeah, I mean, it wasn't so much that it was hard because he wasn't there, it was hard because we didn't really understand why. And then as we got older, the explanation started coming out, and I think that once it was explained to us, it eased the pain.
Though Dionne was able to put on a strong face for her sons, there was still her own pain to deal with.
After my marriage was over and I was on my own, so to speak, I had to do for me, you know, and it was okay. It took a minute. Like I say, all of a sudden I jumped up and I was free, and that's a crock of crap. And anybody says that they feel that way after something that devastating happens, I find it hard to believe.
Sadly, Bill passed away of a heart attack several years later, and Dionne had to help her sons through their grief.
When my father passed away, I'll never forget that. I mean, it was like 5 a.m. She walked in my room and she said, you know, I have to tell you, you know, I got some really bad news, but I'm gonna let you sleep through the night. And but just know everything is okay. And she, you know, she's rubbing me and my brother, and we fell back asleep. And when we woke up in the morning, she was like, I wanted to tell you, but when I walked in, I didn't want you guys not to get through the evening. And for her, I mean, that's unbelievable.
His death was really traumatic for me. I was older than my brother, so I had a different relationship with my father than my brother. So my mom, for me, really stepped in as a pillow, as comfort, because I was really hurt. I was hurt through my soul. She rebuilt me, basically, you know, from ground up. Never missed a beat. She'd be a million miles away, but would still be right next to me the whole way through.
Dionne continued to work, but her boys always came first.
I'm glad, because I have a lot of friends who have parents in the business, and they weren't kind of given the same morals and the same support, you know, that my mom gave me and my brother, even when she was 3,000 miles away.
I can't ever say one time that I missed or ever said, I don't have a mom because she's on the road.
When David and Damon weren't in school, Dionne would bring them on tour.
My mom would be in Las Vegas playing the glamorous Las Vegas with the likes of Sammy Davis Jr., Frank Sinatra. And as a kid, just to feel the air of Hollywood like that, and to see that, you know, my mom was right there in the mix, I mean, it was pretty impressive.
But though Dionne continued to play to packed houses, she wasn't scoring hit after hit as she had earlier in her career.
She was headlining in Las Vegas, she was headlining in cabarets, but she was not actively making records.
It got to the point, recording-wise, where I felt I had just come to a crossroads where a decision had to be made. Either I was going to remain in the business, or I was going to use my credentials as a teacher and go ahead and teach.
Just as she was about to turn her back on the business, fate stepped in. In 1979, Dionne did a concert in Central Park. Clive Davis, the legendary head of Arista Records, was in the audience.
She knocked me out. And so I said, you know, I'm going to try to sign Dionne.
He basically said to me one day, you may be ready to give up the industry, but the industry is not ready to give you up.
Clive Davis had a plan that would take Dionne's career to the next level. It was the height of the disco era, but rather than try and turn Dionne into the next Donna Summer, Davis carved out a new niche for the satin voice singer.
He gave me Barry Manilow as my producer, my first producer at Arista.
I said, Barry, we're going to launch Dionne, and we're going to really do it with this song, I'll Never Love This Way Again, and I'd love you to produce it.
The album, Deja Vu, became Dionne's comeback.
He garnered my first number one record, very first number one record.
Dionne Warwick!
Dionne was back, and the world took notice. That year, she took home 2 Grammy Awards. Dionne's next album for Arista, Heartbreaker, paired her with the Bee Gees and was another huge success. Now a fixture in pop music, Dionne began to branch out into other professional directions. In 1980, she hosted the Music Countdown variety show, Solid Gold. The program offered Dionne a chance to work with other performers and old friends. In 1985, Dionne got an opportunity to work with one of her oldest friends, Burt Bacharach. It had been 10 years since their falling out, and they hadn't spoken to each other since.
Aaron Spelling did a series, didn't last very long, Find Dove, Lost Loves, and had asked Burt to write the theme for it, and literally told Burt, the only person that could sing, this is Dionne. So call him, and that's what he had to do. And he called me on my private line. So not too many people had my private number. And I wanted to know, who is this? And Bert. Bert who?
Bert asked if he could come over to play the song, and Dionne agreed.
It was like waiting for a blind date. You don't know what's going to be on the other side of that door because of the period of time that had lapsed.
I played for her, she loved it. And, you know, it wasn't so tough.
It was like that much time really had passed between the time we had seen each other last. And what resulted from that is the relationship started mending itself with he and with Hal as well. And it was like old times.
Still got these great legs. Huh?
Though Finder of Lost Loves wasn't Dionne's biggest hit, it did rekindle her friendship with Burt Bacharach and Hal David.
Yes, for you.
Ladies and gentlemen of the orchestra, this Hello. Is Dionne Warwick, my sister.
Yes, mending sister. Pieces is something I love doing. I really do. Because as I said, there's nothing that cannot be talked out. That's the human thing that we all possess. All we have to do is use it. And it worked. It just worked.
The healed friendship would then help millions of people that needed healing themselves. Following the lead of the all-star charity recording We Are the World, Dionne decided to record a song to benefit victims of AIDS. The song, That's What Friends Are For, was written by Burt Bacharach and his then-wife, Carol Bayer Sager.
As it happened, Burt and Carol are friends, very dear friends of Elizabeth Taylor. And Elizabeth said, well, you know, This would be a wonderful song to associate with the AIDS situation. It could become the anthem of the AIDS situation.
We all knew people that were dying or on their way out of this world. It was a terrible time. You know, somebody whose life was touched by it.
Dion invited Gladys Knight, Stevie Wonder, and Elton John to join her on the charity recording.
Keep smiling, keep shining, knowing you can always count on me. For sure, that's what friends are for.
Because Elton, Gladys, Stevie, and I had lost people to this disease. And our industry especially was just being ravaged with it. We thought, yeah, okay, makes sense. You know, if it's gonna do some good, let's go for it.
For good times and bad times, I'll be on your side forevermore. That's what friends are for.
For Dion to establish herself as the first person in the music business to really get up there and talk about AIDS was so impressive to me. And that record was a huge record. And, you know, kind of kick-started me into the AIDS arena as well in the music business. And she should be really praised for that.
She was just saying, somebody's got to step up to the plate.
Her generosity is also akin to her talent and ability.
The song raised over $1 million for AIDS research.
I remember some class they said to me, that was so funny, but it's so true. He said, you know what? You gave up the biggest hit record that you'll probably ever have in your lifetime. He said, but guess why you gave it up? I said, it's because that's what friends are for.
That's What Friends Are For won 2 Grammys in 1986, but there were other rewards. The experience led Dion to travel the world to raise money for the deadly disease.
Hi, I'm Dion Warwick, and this is my friend, Sean. He has AIDS. I'm not afraid of him, and you don't have to be either.
In 1987, Dion was named a U.S. Ambassador of Health.
My self-imposed mandate was to be the voice for the voiceless and be that persona who stood in front of the Senate and in Congress and the President and let them know what was needed and necessary to aid people that were in dire need. It was just the right thing to do.
Coming up next, Dion gets caught up with some psychic friends.
I don't know how psychic she was or anything like that, you know.
Then later, Dion sings a very special duet.
I'm gonna ask him to come back to the stage, David Elliott.
It's funny, I come off the stage doing my set, and before she can even go on stage, I'm like, Mom, what'd you think?
When Lifetime's intimate portrait of Dionne Warwick continues. We now return to Lifetime's intimate portrait of Dionne Warwick. Doing things right and from the heart was always first and foremost for singer Dionne Warwick, not only in her personal life, but professionally as well.
She was always trying to help somebody, you know, a lot of times to her own detriment.
This was the case in 1990 when Dionne was asked to host the popular infomercial, The Psychic Friends Network.
She wasn't the kind of person that would dot all the I's and cross all the T's. It was just hard for her. Okay, can you do that for us? Okay, you do that.
She'll get caught up in something that just because of her pure naiveness and just being generally good will backfire.
Dion had dabbled in psychic interests before.
I've had readings on several occasions, as I'm sure a lot of other people have. Looked in the newspaper to see what I wasn't supposed to do with my chart that day.
But hosting the show was merely a job.
I don't know how psychic she was or anything like that, you know. I don't know how psychic or what she believed in that as much as one might say. I just think it was another way of just making money.
But by the mid-90s, the job began to change the public's perception of Dion.
I don't know. I think that was a downtime for Dionne.
Dionne was finally able to distance herself after the producers of the infomercial were accused of fraud and filed for bankruptcy. Now Dionne had to rediscover herself as a singer at a time when her record label was focusing on new, younger artists, including her own cousin, Whitney Houston.
Dionne used to be the one to take Whitney on the road. When I was just being a homemaker, she would take her on the road with her. You know, she got her used to the Bel Air and all that kind of business, you know.
In 1993, Dionne recorded a duet with Whitney for her Friends Can Be Lovers album. Dionne had another opportunity to work with young artists, but it came in a roundabout way. In 1994, she began to speak out against violent and demeaning rap lyrics.
When rap music happened, it was wholesome, fun, kind of play on words, rhyming. And, it was very much like we all grew up doing when we jumped double dutch and played jacks or stoop ball or those kinds of things where we made up rhymes that went along with what we were doing, hopscotch. All of a sudden, something called gangsta rap happened.
She went on TV and said, you know, I don't care for I don't care for what these hip hop rappers are saying, what Snoop Dogg is saying.
I don't know where these children had the ability to use words that they were using and descriptions that they were giving and just some of the total misogynistic ambiance of these recordings. And I didn't mind speaking up and saying so.
While Dionne was speaking her mind, her son Damon was beginning his career as a producer for several well-known hip-hop artists.
And here I am, being in it all as a producer, thinking that I'm really starting to succeed and I'm making some good money right now, you know. And she's shutting it down and I'm going, Mom, what are you doing? Like, Mom, this is my dream. And I totally get her whole, you know, everything she's talking about. But I still was saying, Mom, don't go public with it because you're gonna look crazy to the kids who are in the hood and who think, you know, this is their way of expression.
It's a way of expressing, I'll grant that. However, there is a way to express yourselves without cursing at me.
And it went around and around. And then finally, I came up with an idea with her.
Dionne would give over half a dozen hip-hop stars the chance to sing one of her hit songs, which dealt with another four-letter word, love.
At the time, there was the West Coast contingency, and there was the East Coast contingency, and you can't put them all in the same room. That's a bunch of crap.
We all made up, and we did a song called What the World Needs Now, and it's, everybody knows the song, Love, Sweet Love, but we flipped it and did it hip-hop style.
They each wrote their own lyric content that they were going to speak. Not one curse word, not one misogynistic inference. There was a prerequisite that the lyric value, the song value, had to remain what it was. We would not jeopardize the integrity of what the world needs now is love. And they all understood it.
Ow, you're always in, and that's for sure. And that's what friends are for.
And everybody that heard that recording said, how did you get them to do that? I didn't. They did it themselves. It came from their souls. And I learned something that day. That we have some brilliant human beings in those youngsters.
Not only did the song have the makings of a hit, it made Dionne a godmother to the hip-hop community.
I became Auntie D, I became Mommy D. It was okay, you know, because that's the way they looked at me as that figure, which was fine. I didn't care because my children were their ages.
So it was so powerful. Like, it was, man, I still listen back to it.
At the end of the 1990s, Dionne expanded her musical horizons even further when she released an album of Brazilian songs.
My Brazilian album, I think is some of my best work. I love their music. I understand their music. I feel their music.
The experience launched a spiritual transformation as well.
Brazil, if you've never been there, is somewhere that you need to experience through and through. Just on the music level, it's unbelievable. The people are so spiritual, and it seems like their whole culture moves by rhythm.
In 1998, Dion made Brazil her second home.
Brazil and my mom, that's a marriage made in heaven, really.
Brazil is probably the best thing that I've ever done for me, ever.
I know why she loves it. I mean, she goes down there and she can just let go, completely just relax and just give herself to the earth. And it's just unbelievable.
Coming up next, Dion wins the ultimate Grammy.
She loves when the kids call her Grammy because she's like, I ain't no grandma.
When Lifetime's intimate portrait of Dionne Warwick continues. We now return to Lifetime's intimate portrait of Dionne Warwick. Over the last decade, Dionne Warwick has traveled the world, continuing to delight audiences with her huge repertoire of hits.
If you see me walking down the street and I start to cry each time we meet.
Each one of these songs are like my children. I love each and every single one of them. The ones that were hits and the ones that weren't. And then there are many that I kind of buried in, we called them albums at the time.
Dionne's albums and performances have created memories for several generations.
It's so nice to see from my stage and look into the audience, their wonderful smiles, and you hear people singing with you. We want you to feel absolutely free to just open up your mouths, let some words roll around it.
I've seen probably, thousands of shows of hers over and over again. And each time, even though I know all this, you know, I know the whole show.
And if the spirit should move you.
It still feels new every time to me. And it still gives me those chills.
Well, if that should occur, and you feel like you want to just get on up and let it all hang loose, it's quite all right with us.
And I know if it affects me like that, I can only imagine how it affects one of her fans that are sitting right next to me, who's really paid for a ticket and who's like, oh man, I'm sitting there with Dionne Warwick, wow.
She's an all-time great. She should be in every Hall of Fame, including the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. She has been that influential, that unique, and that special.
Now, Dionne is getting ready to revisit her hits with the help of a few famous friends.
It's a duet project celebrating my 40 years in show business. So I called 40 friends. I asked each of them to choose their favorite Dionne Warwick recording, and that would be the song that we would do as a duet. And, first of all, the response was overwhelming. It was just so wonderful to get, you know, unanimous. Yes, we have favorite Dionne Warwick songs, and yes, we'll be a part of this.
The recording will feature Dionne singing with old friends such as Barry Manilow, George Benson, and Gloria Estefan, as well as new friends Maya and the members of Destiny's Child. It will also include a very special duet.
And I want you to give a very warm and loving round of applause to help me bring him to the stage, if you will. Receive my son, Mr. David Elliott. David is opening my shows for me.
It's funny, I come off the stage doing my set, and before she can even go on stage, I'm like, Mom, what'd you think? She's like, oh, you know, we'll talk after my set, and she pulls me in the dressing room, gives me the notes, and it's just an unbelievable experience, and I really, really hope that it's, you know, just settles into me and I can, you know, give just a tenth of what she's given to the world.
I say a prayer, I say a little prayer for you. Answer my prayer, baby. Won't you answer my prayer?
Both on stage and off, Dionne's pride in her sons is evident.
Both exceptionally handsome, both exceptionally talented, loving, caring, giving human beings.
Whenever possible, Dion spends time with her 5 grandkids, who call her, appropriately, Grammy.
She made up that name, Grammy, because she says that was one of her happiest moments when she received not only 1, 2, 3, 4, but 5 Grammys. And she loves when the kids call her Grammy, because she's like, I ain't no grandma.
Grammy's great. I mean, I look at my kids and say, see, you guys are feeling what I felt when I grew up, and I'm just so happy that they get to experience the same kind of love and joy and fun. I mean, my mom is, she's just fun, you know? She's just so much fun. And I'm so happy that my kids get to feel her greatness and her fun.
Dion has also remained socially conscious. In 2002, she was named a global ambassador for the United Nations Food and Agricultural Organization. Dion finally feels ready to share the lessons she's learned over the years. She's releasing a book of her photographs and philosophies entitled My Point of View.
It's just pearls of wisdom that I've garnered over the years from my grandparents, my mom and dad, my friends, and people that I didn't even know that just kind of threw something at me that stuck. And I'm willing to share those things because they've helped me. And it helps somebody in reading and saying, you know, that can be applied to what I'm doing. Then I've done my job, you know.
Dionne Warwick has brought joy to millions and to herself by keeping the faith.
If you can think it, you can do it is something my grandpa gave me. I think it must have been about 9 or 10 years old, because I had always said that, oh, I think I want it. He said, well, if you can think it, you can do it. He always said that. And it has become my mantra.
And she's still believing.
I haven't even scratched the surface of the things that I want to accomplish. So I keep thinking, and I keep doing.
Don't you love it that Dionne Warwick became a kind of mother figure to some pretty rough gangster rappers? They may tell her, don't make me over, but leave it to Dionne to find a way. For Lifetime's Intimate Portrait, I'm Meredith Vieira.